I'm just kidding. Welcome to April, and it's a beautiful day out, but it'll probably snow this weekend. So, Hillary, you want to introduce our program today?
So Avon has prepared a magnificent video, and he said he wanted an excuse to show it. So I really don't have to introduce him because the video will do all of that. So without further ado, let's watch this wonderful video.
Maybe I was 2 or 3 when I ran out of drawing paper and started drawing on walls with crayons. My parents never again let me run out of paper.
The morning light rise above the golden hills.
I grew up in isolation on our farm. I came to know nature long before I learned of human nature.
We never thought the wind would blow cold.
I learned the names of all the plants and trees long before I could read or write. Trees, rocks, and streams, they all have different personalities. They have different moods. My art helps others see this too. Today I paint what I know best, all that is natural. When I was young, I still find peace and comfort when I'm in the wild. There, I'm with old friends.
Lift up your head, break down the walls.
For me, nature tells the truth. It never lies or deceives. It isn't unreliable, and it never has cheated me. It is always giving, even when it is at its most destructive. My art shares the calming effect of the wild, all of its moods and its forces. People connect to my work by a shared emotional response to the moods that I find in nature. By painting the air around a thing rather than the thing itself, I create mood and emotion others relate to. Many have said I create places they want to enter. I think they are relating to the captured moods of that atmosphere.
At first the sun might hurt you.
Lori Waxman, a Chicago Tribune art critic, once said of my work, I amplify nature by leaving out the one element that nearly always mucks up scenery, humans.
Illuminates your paws through time.
Well, that was embarrassing.
Was that you singing?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was my singing. Well, thanks for having me again. When Hillary asked for me to do another workshop, it had only been a couple of years since I did one. And there's always a requirement to do a demonstration. So I figured that a lot of you might be tired of seeing me. So what better way to get you tired than do a video? So we have a workshop coming up on tonalism. And I got interested in tonalism about 4 years ago. And a little louder? Okay, they told me where the button was, so we're going to...
We're good. I got you.
You got me? Oh, look at that. I don't even have to play with buttons. Okay, so... I started with tonalism about 4 years ago, and that's something that I've really found that I like to continue with. So this workshop is going to be on learning how to use different values, and it's going to, if you've had a little bit of color theory and tonalism by studying values, for me, it kind of capped off all those missing parts that through the years that I'd never understood. I had a great teacher for this also, Carol Strock-Wasson. So if you ever get a chance to, we heard a hand for Carol too. So if you ever get a chance to take a class from her, several of us in here have. I know Vicki has and some others have. So feel free to ask what you want and we'll be glad to steer you her way. So values, basically, this pastel class that's coming up on, what is it, the 29th?
29th,
the Saturday. This pastel class is going to hopefully fill in what it did for me when I learned about values. Somehow, when I went to college and I went to art school, somehow I lost, maybe they brought it up. Maybe they brought up color theory and values. You know, they talked about when one color is next to another, it changes even though it's the same color. But that wasn't values. That was the relationships and interactivity of color and the reflective colors. So I learned all that. But somehow I missed something on values. So I don't know whether they just didn't teach it and I was, or they taught it and I was too dense to get it through. But, you know, it, lo and behold, I'm in my 60s and I finally, it's like, oh, it's clicking, you know? So the idea here is that maybe if you've had a little color theory, this class is structured in such a way that we'll talk about the differences between values, tones, saturation. Unfortunately, the art community doesn't use one nomenclature. So we have all these different words, chroma. You'll hear some people talk about chroma. You'll hear some people talk about density. You know, there's all these different words. And so what I want to do with this workshop is while we're studying value, try to get the people in the workshop to understand what words, when they hear these things, some of them mean the same thing, and some of them are different than maybe what they thought. So I'm going to do a demonstration tonight using tonalism. I usually work from sketches rather than, even if I'm outside, I will do sketches, and I'll work from a black and white. As long as I'm working from a black and white, I can put in any color I want. So it's not unusual. Have anybody ever seen one of my orange skies? Anybody? Okay. All right. It's not unusual for the sky to be a different color than blue or the grass to not be green for a lot of my work. I really got, when I lived in California, I got interested in color. And the California palette is really, really interesting because around there, there's like 1 month that it rains. It's like January or February or the middle of January, middle of February. And everything turns green. And sometimes the poppies come out early. And you get all these reds against the golden. After that green, it all turns golden for the rest of the year. And sometimes then the poppies come out if you get enough rain. And so I developed this California palette. They even used it in the street scenes. A lot of golds, a lot of lavenders, and a lot of oranges, and violets, and purples. And then I moved back to Indiana. And it's like, what do I do with all this green? I mean, it's green. I never realized until I lived in California how green Indiana was. And I have to tell you, there's probably a 5 or 10 year period where I had some of these god-awful paintings that were just really, you know, I tried to use color, but it just wasn't working with green. So gradually I passed through that and I ended up with something that I can live with at least. So we're gonna do it looks like the one I've picked here is a cloud formation over one of Indiana's great hilly landscapes, you know, where the horizon goes up about a quarter inch and then it goes back down another quarter inch. So those are always challenging, unlike when you go to southern Indiana and you get the hills intersecting and you get these natural curves of things and going around these hills and stuff. I enjoy the challenge of the plains of Indiana because it really makes you connect with, you know, trying to capture what you feel and not have it be static. So I may succeed with this demo, I may not. We'll see what happens, you know. First of all, I want to show you a little bit about color. Who would like to volunteer to put 10 colors in an order from light to dark? Do I have a volunteer? Please, volunteer. Yes, we have a volunteer. What's your name? Patricia. All right, Patricia. All right. I have 19 colors here, and what I'd like Patricia to do is pick 10 of them, and you can, you can pull them. You want gloves? Because these, okay. You can, line them up, shuffle them around. You know, anybody seen the guy with the cup and the little pea? All right, so feel free to do the little cup and the pea. And I want you to pick 10 out of the 19 and put them from lightest to darkest, okay? And while she's doing that, I'll tell you a little bit more about tonalism and what got me into it. This is a great book. If you're ever interested in tonalism, it's by David Cleveland. And it came out, and the American tonalists are considered to be, well, you know how people say jazz is an all-American, it originated here. Well, tonalism is like that. The artists back in the 1800s went to Germany, and they went to England, and they went to France to learn painting. And the artist then came back here and started painting. At the time, the Hudson School, down the Hudson River, obviously, and the Hudson Valley, the Hudson School was really in vogue, and they were the rage. And then in the 1880s, after the Civil War, there was a rebellion by, imagine this, the young people rebelled. Okay, so the young artists coming back from Europe decided they wanted to do something different, and they started working in this form of art called tonalism. And it basically then took over, and the Hudson School fell out of vogue, and the tonalists were basically active between 1880 and 1920. And David Cleveland wrote this book, and I'll pass this around, but it is a fantastic book. It takes you all the way up to, his thesis says that modern art was influenced by the tonalist painters because they were truly an American bred and formed type of art. The one exception is, and he was an American though, but living in England, and that was Whistler. And Whistler, you'll find some of his pictures in here also. So I'll pass this around. Start with you, and feel free to look at it and just pass it on or whatever. So, are we running close?
I think so.
All right, here we go.
I don't know if I got the right order though.
Okay, there's no wrong answers. Okay, all right, now this right here is, you can see the colors. And this is a demonstration to show you what tonalism is. Tonalism is not dealing with the color. Tonalism is dealing with the value. And a lot of people confuse color with value. So I'm going to show how this looks. This camera is black and white. Believe it or not, they make a black and white camera. And when you look at this through here, all you've got to do is just push this little button right here, and you'll see that the separation of color is a whole lot less in black and white than it is when you look at it in color. So that's a little bit, when you look at that, it's going to look like a band of gray with just very little difference between each one of those colors. So, is it working for you?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So there's a little bit of difference between them, and because I didn't put them side by side and there's a little white space, you can see where the separation is. But when you look through the camera, you're going to see that when those colors are changed to black and white, that they're basically almost the same one tone or same value is what they would say. Now, tonalists work in different scales. Most of them work in 1 to 10, so 10 different values. And when you at break, you can come up and see my pastels. Rather than set my pastels up where I have like all my yellows and yellow greens going to green and then going to red and red violets and oranges and then blues and blue violets. Rather than do that, what I've done is I've set my palette up by value. So I have all these colors mixed together, and I have on in this first tray, I've put it in five trays. The first tray has values 1 and 2. 1 would be as close to black as you can get without being black, and then black would be included. The second tray is 3, and the third tray is number values 4 and 5, and then 6 and 7 are in the fourth tray, and 8, 9, and 10 are your very lightest colors. Now you'll see sometimes those are reversed. And we'll be using the grayscale, but this is the grayscale. I'll pass this around. And you can see, make sure that this one is, yeah, value 1 is black on here. And when you look at it, it's not really true black. So it's the dark darks. And value 10 is white. So we can pass that around too. Okay. Any questions before I start the demo? Yes. Using tonalism and the tonal values are the same, whether it's watercolor, oil, acrylic, or whatever. The difference is that if I mix up oil, I was an oil painter most of my life, and I switched about 6.5 years ago to pastel as trying to take a break. And I fell in love with pastel because instead of like, oh, that color's not right, and I have to mix up another set of colors, I just put the one stick down and pick up another stick. So once you try pastel, and we have a new pastel society here. All right, I like to use these gloves because my hands crack with the dry chalks and things. Now, typically when I do typically when I do paintings in my studio, I will use a number of different mediums. I'll use water, I'll use alcohol, I'll use airbrush medium, I'll use acrylic glaze medium. I'll use a lot of different mediums. I've even used turpentine and gambasol, although those take about 3 days to dry, so that advantage of not having to mix up a color. I got 3 days to mix up colors. I could do it in oil. So what I like to do when I start out with pastel is I like to just put some color on, and it may not be, I may decide in my head that I'm going to try to do things in blues and violets with maybe kind of a complementary highlight with an orange or a yellow. So I've got this set of clouds here, and I think I'm going to try to stay in the 6 and 7 value range. I might drop down into the 5s. So I'll be pulling everything out of this one tray pretty much and starting that way. So and I don't put the pastel on very heavy. I just try to keep it light and airy. And I'm not trying to duplicate everything that's in a small drawing, because the drawing's so small, I'll end up having to try to add things to it. And shout out a question if you have anything.
So what value is that? 5, 6, 7?
These are in the 6 and 7 range.
How do you determine?
How do I determine the value?
What number it is?
I determine the value by to set up my pastels. I take that grayscale that's going around, and you kind of squint, and you squint your eyes down until you find something that matches. Now, pastels get dirty, so I usually will stick them on a piece of paper in case the pastel, like this one's a really creamy kind of beige yellow, but you can't see it. It almost looks pink in my hand. So by putting it on a piece of paper and then taking the grayscale and squinting, I try to find, you'll find that the sometimes these fall in between, like 4.5, but there's, so you gotta make a decision. Am I gonna put it in my 5 tray or am I gonna put it in my 4 tray? So. And when I use pastels, I try to, because I want to come back to some of them, I try to separate them. I know some artists will take another tray and separate them out that way, but I like to keep them in a tray and pull them out later. And sometimes the trays get pretty full because as I go through this, I'll change my mind.
So speaking of your mind.
Speaking of my mind, okay.
What are you thinking about as you're applying the color? I see you looking at the sketch and then doing large areas of color, but what's going on in your mind as you're planning?
Nobody really knows what? That.
So the question is, what's going on in my mind as I'm planning?
They lobbed it in there. I hit it, okay?
The thing that goes through my head, you've all heard the thing about what's the last thing that goes through a bug's mind when he hits the windshield. Well, that might be the same for me. I'm thinking about color harmonies. I'm thinking about lights and darks. Even though I'm in the same value and you turn this gray, there's going to be very little difference between the light and the dark. But I want the perception that the viewer sees as a cloud that will have a light area and goes gray. So I'm trying to figure out where to put my lights and then add the darks. And then I'm thinking about, as I blend my lights and darks, like this cloud, I started with the light color first, the lightest color, because I know that when I go in my alcohol, I know that it's going to be, I know it's going to kind of mud things up. So now I'm blending some of these colors together, and if I do it fast enough, I get some interesting results as it runs. And my wet pastel technique class is something totally different. But this is just the way I like to work, is I like to try to get a lot of mixing going on and have, as Bob Ross says, these little happy accidents going on.
Are you using water there?
This is alcohol. This is probably 70%. I have used, I think it's 92 isopropyl. And I have used that in the past, but for me, it dries just a little too fast, especially during a demo. If I stop and talk too much without painting, I won't get the blending I'm looking for. But, oh, look what's happening here. All these nice little runs down in here. Look at that cloud. It almost looks like there's a rain cloud going underneath it there. And while it's wet and I can move things around, I'm able to move some of this paint and try to get this cloud. You know how a cloud will be a highlight in one area and it'll go gray. I'm not worried about the value of that gray yet as it relates to the other values on the page. Because again, I'm all one value, okay? So having the values, I'm working more now as I think about it, knowing that my values are all similar. I can use the lights or the hues and the brightness or saturation of the hues to create some of the effects that I'm really thinking of and see subtle evidences of here in this. But yeah, I'm liking that. Now it's got to dry so I can answer a few more questions. But I had to get that kind of brushed in. And you can see that I've picked some unusual colors, but they'll work out when I'm done. So,
what kind of paper are you using?
I'm using sanded paper. The question was, what kind of paper? I'm using sanded paper. And sanded paper is there's a couple different ones now, but UART is a major manufacturer. And this is 400 grit. They make 600, which is great for portraits and fine detail, but I'm not interested in detail. So, other questions? John, I need your hot air over here. I didn't bring a blow dryer.
Got you covered. Got you covered. As always.
Got you back.
What's going through your mind now?
All the things you want to call me. All right. So I have some basic shapes in, and I normally will let this dry, but because we're doing a demo and on some time schedule here, I can go back into this while it's wet. So the one thing that does, if you're using pastel, is it creates a little bit of a hard spot that you have to kind of rub off later, and it will make a little dark spot on your pastel. But my cornmeal normally will take almost all that off.
Cornmeal,
that's what's in these trays, to keep my pastels clean. Yeah. So is the Everclear, if I ever use Everclear instead of isopropyl. Yeah, I had somebody tell me, I think it was Nancy King Mertz. I was in one of her workshops, and she says, you know, I've started taking, maybe it was somebody else, but I started taking vodka to workshops, because we put this, people started putting the isopropyl in like their little plastic cups, and somebody came along and thought it was their drinking cup. And so that can get uncomfortably ugly in a hurry. Other questions? And now this is still wet, so it's going on differently, which I kind of like. A lot of times I will stop after one or two applications, and I will put a clear gesso in order to get even a stronger texture on this. At times, these pastels or the colors and hues that I use will change. From beginning to end quite a bit.
Explain what you mean by hues instead of values.
Pardon me?
Explain what you mean by hues
instead of
values.
Okay. A lot of people will say this is the color yellow. Well, the term hue is one of the terms that people use, and hue basically is a substitute for color.
Okay, so you said that this is the tone, and that now you go through and do, wait a minute, see? Okay. I'm going to go to the workshop.
Don't feel bad, because a lot of people use those terms. They interchange them.
Yeah.
And they're, two different artists will use the word hue as two different things.
Yeah, and that's unfortunate that our industry hasn't standardized these things. If you ask anybody who's a civil engineer and works on highways what a road blister is, they'll all know what a road blister is. Anybody here know what a road blister is?
Pothole.
No, but that's a good guess. You know when somebody's turning left and you, rather than you wait on them, there's a little area to the right that blisters out? That's a road blister.
Now you will probably win a game of Trivial Pursuit if you don't forget.
And the smell of asphalt after a rain is called petrichor. And half the fun is sorting through the pastels and finding all these pretty colors that you can try. And the neat thing is that when you put an orange next to a blue, if it is not in the same value range, it will stick out like a sore thumb. But if it is in the same value range, then you can make some small marks with an orange, and as the painting progresses, they'll start to vibrate because they're so close together as far as the value is concerned. But if I'm working in the 6 and 7 value range, if I put a 3 or a 1 or a 2 orange up there, it just wouldn't work with the blue. And when you come up and look at this, you'll see a lot of colors close. And when you look at it, if you squint your eyes down where you're looking through your eyelashes, then you'll start to see how everything kind of comes together, even though they're all different colors. Several artists have said anything that you paint can be any color as long as the value is correct. So learning value is really, really important part of color theory. Still wet down here. I knew I should have thrown in the hair dryer. It's all right, it's fun to work into wet.
I wonder if you ever think about going from dark to light.
Me?
Yes, you.
Dark, going from dark to light? I usually try to work from my darks to light, except for when I'm putting on, I'm kind of getting like a watercolor person who works from light.
I noticed that.
Because when I started with the alcohol, when I do wet mediums, I will go from light to dark, which is opposite. So one day I should
take up... No, it's the correct way.
But it's opposite of watercolor. It's the correct way. If you ever take up pastel, the first thing you'll see is you get these nice, pretty long sticks. I just broke this one because it was way too long for me to handle. And I wanted to try to get some smaller marks in here, and it was not working at the size that it was. And that one I can tell is already too big.
I see maybe three or four that are full sticks. Here's one. No, it's not anymore. Sorry about that.
Oh, that was my $20 stick. You can pay me later, John.
I'll make you a deal on a book, okay?
Okay.
I don't know anything. So, like, how is that not the, like, orange cream color not vibrating right now?
This right here?
Yeah.
It's not the right tone yet, or it's not the right amount of, it's not the right shade. Shade would be light, degree of lightness, because I need a little bit more in here. This is where, near the end, I probably will pop up into the box 8 or 9 value in order to just add a little bit more light in there. But I usually wait until the very end to do that. What I'm concentrating now on is I'm concentrating on trying to get a lot of different color in here. And typically at this particular point in my studio, I would hit this with some sort of liquid medium in order to get some runs and get some shapes. But I'm having to rely on mark making at this particular point to try to get some of those shapes. But the colors will change as I go, and I will move them from a lighter shade to a darker shade as I get near the finish. But right now there are a lot of marks that are not the right hue or color. But the shade of lightness and darkness has to be done near the end, because I want the majority of this picture to be in the 6 and 7 value range. But wherever I want it to pop or I want it to recede, then I will go down and make small marks in small areas that are darker or lighter. Okay, so this will change by the end.
Thank you.
Coming together?
Yes.
Yeah, what's going on here?
That's kind of normal. You get used to that with him.
How many layers do I put on? As many as it takes, which is kind of a vague answer. But I am really into texture, and I'm really into color. So if I stood back, And I looked at this and thought that, you know, oh, this is almost done, then I wouldn't really, me, think it's almost done, because I want a lot more marks. I haven't even touched this sky. It's kind of like just been washed in, and I've got to get up there and start making some. Right now the sky is kind of going straight up, and the sky needs to come up over us. So I've got some work to do on that area there, too.
Avon?
Yes?
Could you talk a little bit about composition?
No.
And the importance of composition with this?
No, I'm already confusing people. Okay, I will. Matter of fact, that's the last class I taught 2 years ago. I studied composition for several years and devoured it. And what I found was that there are a number of designs that artists have used through the years that are successful, and a number of designs that are very overused. And I tend to overuse a couple myself, and I have to force myself into using other designs. If you can take a look at... there's a guy named Edgar Payne. He has written the book on composition that a lot of people use today. And that book, what he does is he breaks it down into picture design. This particular picture design will have kind of a Z shape bringing the viewer up into here. You can barely see a little bit of it here, and I started bringing some of it out in here. It's kind of covered up now. So the viewer will come into here and across here, because I can't just have a band of color for the field or grass or pasture or whatever it turns into be. I'm not worried what it is right now. I'm more worried about trying to get the color in right now and lay in some shapes that will lead me to bring the eye up and across and up in here. Now you see the distance between here and here, from this side of the trees to this side of the trees. I'm going to have to do something about that, because if I go bring the viewer in here and across here, I need to also bring them up here and then back and around. So composition is very important. You can't just rely on color, and you can't just rely on color theory. Does that answer your question?
Thank you. What's your favorite pastel brand?
Oh, that's going to vary from person to person. My favorite is Unison.
Is that the kind I just broke?
Yeah, that's these. The Unison pastels are very soft.
Yeah, I know.
But they don't have a lot of grit in them, and they don't have a lot of binder in them. So the colors tend to be a little purer than some of the others that I've used. I first started out with Hobby Lobby pastels, and that was because I wasn't sure I was going to like pastels. And I ended up using those, and then I got Great America, which are out of Cincinnati. And Great America are very buttery, and I liked those for a while when I was doing birds and things. But I just didn't like the butteriness, because it would pile up on my page. And so some people like that. I talked to another artist, it's like, oh, I like it when it does that, because it almost resembles like when you take a loaded paintbrush and you've got a paint mark on there. But for me, it wasn't working, because I guess what I'm looking for is are lines and marks and textures, and it wasn't letting me do that. So then I bought a bunch of pastels that, I don't know what that noise was, but that was weird. Then I bought a bunch of pastels that were by different manufacturers, two or three sticks of all different manufacturers. And that's when I found out I like Unison, so I went out and I bought a bunch of Unisons.
So why would you recommend as a starter?
If you're not sure you're going to stay with pastel, I recommend Dick Blick or Faber Pitt Minis. Huh?
Faber-Castell.
Yeah, that's it. Faber-Castell, and they've got the word Pitt, P-I-T-T, in there. Well, no, these were sticks. They were like, yeah, they were a little softer what's the hard pastel everybody gets? New pastel. That's the other thing. They make a soft pastel. They make a hard pastel. But none of them are, when they say soft, none of them are all the same softness. And when they say hard, none of them are the same hardness. They're all over the place. So you basically have to buy a few and try them out. And that's why when I ordered two or three sticks of two or three, four different manufacturers, I quickly found out. I can tell you the hardest pastel I've ever run across was Caron. It's made in Switzerland. Caran d'Ache, I don't know French, but that thing is hard as a rock. It looks like a new pastel, and I went like this, and nothing came off. And I went like this again, and it was like very little came off. And then somebody later told me, they said, oh, there's no consistency in the sticks. Some of the colors are softer, and some of them are harder. So the dark ones are harder?
I read somewhere, but I think it's wrong. There's a dust element that you think health-wise, is that a concern?
You should have a well-ventilated area, and I use a HEPA filter, and my furnace ducts blow air across this way, and behind me then is the intake. So you look at this thing, you can see this was almost white when I started, but that was 6 years ago. But I figured the library wouldn't want to be pulling out the pastel out of their carpet. So it doesn't, I think that from what I've read, that the health concerns are a little less with pastel than they are other mediums, because I'm not sure that they use the same heavy metals. I could be wrong. Maybe you know if they use the same heavy metals.
It's all pure pigment.
Yeah.
Gum.
So I couldn't really answer your question about, you know, what's the best pastel to start with, but if you're unsure, an inexpensive one. Because you can easily get into, these sticks are anywhere from $550 to $950 each on some of these manufacturers. And that will add up in a hurry. So figuring out, first of all, whether you like it, and second, if it's anything that you want to do consistently to then buy the colors that you want, I think that's the best way to approach it is, do I like it well enough to keep doing it? And if you don't have a lot of money in it, the colors are surprisingly, you can get good results. The thing is the light fastness. and it doesn't mean you have to throw away those inexpensive colors if you decide to keep with it and get a bigger set or a better set, more expensive, more light, fast colors. You just have to remember, I'm going to do my underpaintings with this older set just to kind of lay in some colors. And then, especially if you start using alcohol or water washes, then you're just kind of setting in some color that you're going to go over with the better set that has more light fastness. Fixative? I use fixative all the time, but not to fix the product. I use fixative to make things run, and I use a fixative, help me out here, Spectrafix. Spectrafix is in a hand pump thing, and I found that it doesn't change your colors and your values like other fixatives, but I'm not after that. I usually, when I'm done, I stick in a mat that will let the powder drop down behind the mat and under glass and with spacers, so I'm not having to fix anything. But a lot of artists don't use fixatives at the end. Do you use fixatives? Yeah.
Avon, that's funny because for 2 years I worked for a framer,
mm-hmm.
a nightmare for the ladies training and breast framing was a pastel person. Because of it, you would get it all framed and then it would drop down and you'd have to redo the whole thing. And then that was wonderful. That was just wonderful. So it's interesting that yours dropped down behind the mat.
Yeah, if you put enough space, and obviously if you don't tilt it forward. Yeah, it is a nightmare. There's many times that things have been, all done, and as soon as I turn it around, I've looked at it before I put the final staples in to hold it. And just the act of sticking those points in will shake enough loose that it's like, you know, I'm down here now with it tilted up this way, facing the front facing that way, and sticking my staples in this way Because as soon as I try to get it vertical and stick it in, it'll jump out, fall on the glass or on the front of the mat, and that defeats the whole purpose of putting all that space in there. So, now you can see I'm starting to make this other side a little bit larger. And again, I like to work just a little bit fast. I'm not happy with my sky yet. Way not happy with my sky yet. I'm gonna have to go to a different value to get what I want in that sky. Now this is my travel palette for workshops and things. My studio palette is very similar. It's still got five spaces, and but it is about twice the size. So the pastels are laid out and easier to find. Now, compared to my drawing, I have widened that horizon quite a bit. The drawing is just basically a guide, and even if I worked from a photograph or I worked outside, I would be working more in terms of using the landscape that was right in front of me more as a reference or a suggestion. I left reality-based imagery a while back, and I just like the freedom of taking landscape and trying to do some things with it that when you stand back and you're all done, it kind of comes together. And if you look at it close, it looks like just a bunch of little pieces. So other questions? You're quiet.
Are you worried about that white spot all the way to the right in the sky?
There? Yeah, it's just paper that didn't get covered yet. I'm just worried about the sky right now. Oh, that was alcohol. What I just used with the brush?
Oh, I know. Yeah. No, you said you used.
Spectrafix. Oh yeah, I spray it on. I let it pool, and I won't spray it over the entire thing. I'll spray it on just a section. Like let's say I sprayed it real close here because I wanted to see some tree trunks. If I try to put those tree trunks in there myself, they'll look like little matchsticks going up and down.
Well, are you talking fixative or are you talking alcohol that you're letting drip?
Both. I let any liquid drip on this.
So is the fixative a workable fixative or the final setting?
It's a final fixative, the Spectrafix.
Yeah.
And the final fixative will still leave. Or because I'm using sanded paper, I'm able to come into here and still feel especially with 400 grit. I've never, probably maybe once in the last 6 years, run out of grit to grab pastel on this sanded paper. Unlike pastel paper, you can fill that pastel paper up pretty quick, and then you got to put a workable fixative on it and go over or brush some off or whatever.
What were you using to blend?
Oh, this is a real expensive blender. It's you get an 8 foot of it. It's pipe insulation. You wrap it around pipes. It's split down the middle. And I bought this about 4 years ago, and I'm on my last four or five pieces now. After 4 or 5 years, I think it was $5. So what's that? $1 a year? Yeah, pool noodles.
What is it called again? The pipe?
Pipe insulation. Yeah. I will sometimes come in here and, like, I put some gray on there that is a value 4 or 5 in order to get this sky start. Like, your question was, that sky was bugging you, wasn't it? The whole thing. Carol, this is a brayer, and when you get a lot of pastel on, you can use this brayer to blend in by going over lights and darks. You can use the edge of it. Like, if I wanted to put tree trunks in here, it's actually taking some of the pastel away. And another cool tool that I'll use when I get near the end, I brought it to show you guys, is this is a clay tool. This has a little rubber tip on it. And you can come in here and you can blend small areas. Like, if I wanted to put sky holes near the end of this, I could put some pastel on there and move that sky hole around with a little sharp tip of that. But we're nowhere near the end. The nice thing about pastel is you make a mistake, you can just wipe it off. You want to make changes, just wipe it off. Now, one of the things you can't see here, because I'm not using a lot of wet mediums, is I'm not getting the texture. When I have texture on here, I can really make a lot of separation of some of these colors. Are you getting happier? That's it. That's what you've been looking for 30 minutes. When's he going to do that? I thought I better do that before you just went nuts. And a lot of times what, as I get closer to an area that I want to add a little bit more, a little more texture sometimes, or a little more detail. I don't usually like adding too much detail. Sky holes are about as detailed as I get. But the nice thing about with values is that you can put something up there and you can just make a little mark and say, oh, is that too light? Is that too dark? It, meaning, because it's the same value, you're making a decision of, is this the right shade of a particular color for that area? Because if we looked at this in black and white, you're not going to see a large separation. And the whole goal of this is to fool the eye and keep the colors in a value range by fooling the viewer's eyes on some of these things.
So is your light source coming directly straight on or from the right?
The light source in this particular one is kind of coming from behind. But I would say it's probably not quite yet behind the clouds. I would say it's probably to the right and maybe overhead more. Now, another reason I use gloves is there's a controversy about, do you blend with your fingers or you don't blend with your fingers? And I've heard different things from artists of different ilk say, don't blend, do blend, it's okay. I'd like to hear a scientific explanation as to, by the manufacturers, or whether we blend or not blend, because I mean, I'm talking about artists that have been around, and they're the people you see in the magazines. They'll all have a different feeling about whether you blend or don't blend. Now, me, because my fingers crack, I'm always wearing gloves, so by not blending with my finger, I'm not getting oil on there, and sometimes I've found that my personal experiments have shown that the oils will, when I get over ready to put a more pastel over an area where I've used my finger, it's not accepting it in the same manner. So take that for what it's worth, because I don't think anybody has a definitive answer unless somebody's done a scientific... Anybody in here heard of a scientific study that proves one way or the other? Huh?
Not scientific.
Not scientific. It's all anecdotal, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, and that's, like, I know people who are into super realism, they blend all the time. I mean, you can't get that realism with a chalk, and especially with, even with, 800 sanded or 600 sanded. And I like a lot of lost edges. So you're seeing me right now try to come into where these trees are kind of in the background. And since my light source is kind of coming in from overhead and over this direction, I'm trying to blend in some of this particular hue into those trees, which is also up in my sky. So it brings things together more, but it also makes the trees sort of kind of disappear into the mist. This isn't going to get done, John.
Get moving. Come on, you're getting paid to do this.
This isn't getting done, John.
Just keep going.
Yes. You would see, except for up in here, because I have grabbed some lighter colors there, the lighter shades of the yellows and pinks, but there wouldn't be a wide difference. If your eye's seen like a lot of contrast, when you change it to black and white, you won't see, you'll see this as much lighter than this, and this kind of a middle tone, but you're not going to see like one's at one end of the spectrum and the other's at the other end of the spectrum. You're not going to see a high contrast. Now see, I just touched this here, and I thought this was going to be dark enough to come in here and do some things that I wanted to do, but it's not. So that's what I mean by if you're in a similar, your eye can really be fooled by the colors. The first demonstration where we had things kind of lined up from lightest to darkest, the colors fool our eyes, and we have to watch that because, and so it, when you get to the point where you can start to work towards a finish on a piece, whether it's tonalism or any other ism, and there's a lot of isms, but when you're working on a piece, it's always good to slow down and not, like if we're working in acrylic or oil, not to mix up something like, yeah, this is the color I want. And you go, oh, that's not the color I needed. So the same thing is true with the pastels. But it's always good to kind of test a small area and expand out as you progress. I have now picked up an orange. I put a blue-green over there, and I picked up an orange because I'm trying to gray down some of these colors that are making up this path or whatever's going up in there. And by putting a little orange over this blue, I'm getting it to mute down some. And as I mute this down, it brings the focus more up into here. But I plan to go back over that with some blues because I don't really want it to be orange. Now, because I put that orange in there, and now I've got this blue-violet, when you get up close to this, you'll see some of that vibration I was talking about that kind of starting to work in places. John knows that I really like sunsets and sunrises, so this is very different for me to have a bright sunny day and do something like this in it. Normally in my studio, I have a lot of loud music going. And I find that helps me kind of get into a rhythm. It's not unusual.
If you're in a studio with several people, just make sure they appreciate your choice of music.
They never do.
I've noticed that as well.
Yeah, they never do. When I turn on some Sidney Bechet jazz, they don't mind that. But then when I turn on some 1990s and 2000 Tool, they get a little bit, I don't know, they start to get jittery.
Yeah, Susan Voigt does not like Little Stephen and the Disciples of Soul.
Oh, really? I'll have to get that. Now you can see what, because I like to deal with atmosphere, I'm really starting to blend that back edge there. It's not quite the right shade, so to speak, but it's getting me going anyway.
How close are you to doing the, like, the darks?
The darks?
Yeah. You want, no, I just
are
wonder.
You, something bugging
because,
you here?
No. No. It's just, by this time in a watercolor, I would be going dark.
You would be going
dark?
By
this time.
All right, John.
No, it's different, because if you put that much color and that many layers, it just gets muddy.
Yeah, that's why you have to quit so soon, John.
No, that's why I get done so quick.
Okay, well, let's see if we can.
No,
I'm
not pushing
you. Oh, no, that's fine. It's always near the end. The darks and lights, I try to stay close within the values.
It's just amazing me how many layers you put on there and you're still getting pure color. So, I mean, it's really cool.
That's the beauty of pastel.
Yeah, yeah.
It's pretty hard to make pastel go muddy if you... there's some dark. But...
That's it?
But I don't like it.
Too dark, too soon.
Too dark, too soon.
We've got to fiddle with this thing for another hour.
Okay, guys, what do I need to work on now, guys? Tell me.
Okay, so that area of vibration.
This area?
Yes. Why is it vibrating?
When you come up here close, come on up here.
Ivan, I'd like you to continue working on it while we're having a meeting. So,
there's a little bit of orange that I put some blue over.
What do you mean vibrate?
Because... blue and orange are opposites.
Yes.
When you put them next to one another, if they're too far apart in values,
yeah,
one will go way forward and one will go way back.
So you're like actually like
and
literally like it's supposed to be moving.
When it, yeah, because you've got the blue, orange, and yellows,
so
and violets. Well, I've covered some of it up with John's dark. Here, watch this.
It's all my color.
Production facilities provided by Access Fort Wayne. Learn more under the Explore tab at acpl.info.
The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. If you or anyone you know might be interested in making a television show, please call 260-421-1250.